The Q45 was the flagship of Infiniti at the time. I think the main thing about the Q45 was that it was very different, breaking the mold of what luxury cars were at the time. It was a heavily layered and nuanced car. In other words, the more time you spent in it, the more you appreciated it, because there were some subtleties about the design that would take time to appreciate. The opposite of sort of an in-your-face luxury car. And the reception was mixed, to be completely honest about it, because a certain part of the car buying public, luxury car buying public, didn't appreciate those subtleties and just wanted a more traditional, conventional luxury car. But there were a lot of people also that really did appreciate this new approach, this new sensibility, if you will, about luxury. One of the parts about the Infiniti Q45 that was very different was the interior design, the interior aesthetic. The story I like to tell here is on one of my trips over to Japan, Mr. Oka and the team were talking about the Japanese tea ceremony. They talked me through it and showed me pictures, and I eventually got to experience one. It took place in a room that was very Spartan, very bare, with only a few decorations. And during the tea ceremony, certain decorations and certain elements of the room would be moved in or moved out. There's a feeling or a philosophy that to really get the most out of the beauty and aesthetic of any one thing, you want to minimize the visual noise. You want to minimize distractions so that the person can focus on that vase or that picture or that plant. And the Q45 had a very simple, clean look to it that stemmed from that aesthetic philosophy. Having wood in a car where it really served no function whatever, in a sense, added visual busyness to the interior. That was just a decision to not include that, and it was a controversial decision. The use of bright work or chrome was fairly minimal on the interior, but there were a few things that really stood out, and one of them was the clock. The clock in the center of the instrument panel was jewel-like. It was beautiful. What elements are present in the interior of the Q45 should really be memorable. They should be cool. There should be a story about them. You could definitely use the word daring about the Q45. As we began to expose the Q45, first in pictures and drawings, and then in actual physical properties and prototypes to journalists, wow, this is really kind of out there, or risky, or daring, or whatever word they used. Nobody ever called the Q45 conventional, but we knew it wasn't going to be something for everybody. And that was great, because we didn't want something for everybody. We didn't want to blend in. We wanted to make a statement. The engine of the Q45 was a work of art. It was so smooth, so powerful, and it made all the right noises and just the right noises. I happened to be on a press trip in Japan at the Tochigi plant where the Q45 was built. We were out near the test track, and I was with Mr. Oka and a few people and some journalists, actually, I think. Two trucks full of Q45s, brand new, first ever trial one vehicles, pulls up. They give Mr. Oka the keys, and he turns and hands me the keys. I would be honored if you would drive my baby. That made me the first person ever to drive a trial one car, other than, you know, the people that put it on the truck, of course. Here I am driving a car at 150, 160 miles an hour, and I feel completely peaceful, calm, yet at the same time, there was exhilaration. That's one of the things that we tried to do in Infiniti in general, was have that exhilaration, but without the fear factor. One of the other features that has been discussed a lot is the lack of a conventional grille on the front of the original Q45. And that also is part of elevating form and function together. You know, the purpose of a grill on a car is to let air in to cool the radiator, to cool the engine, to cool the engine compartment. The way the airflow was managed around the Q45 and the low coefficient of drag that it had, the air management for reduced noise, all of that put together meant that on the Q45, a grill wasn't necessary. The air intake was actually under the bumper level of the vehicle, and that was all the air we needed. To some people, it was a difficult thing to explain. They kind of wanted to see a grill because every other car had a grill. We wouldn't be true to our own philosophy if we just slapped a grill on as an ornament. It needed to have some function to complement the form. I think we were just way ahead of our time.